Today is Sunday, November 15th, and this is a post-market review for the stock market activities on Friday and an outlook for the week to come. Here is the agenda of the day. We have plenty to cover, lots of important headlines to go through, and we will cover the charts analysis per usual, but we'll also review some of the charts and the calls we made throughout the week. And lastly, we will conclude by reviewing the bull versus the bear case for this very, very important and pivotal week. And here we go. The Dow Industrial Average closing in the green with 399.64 points, or a gain of 1.37%. The Nasdaq also in the green by 119.70 points, or a gain of 1.02%. The S&P 500, positive day with 48.14 points, or a gain of 1.36%. And here is the sector's performance on Friday. Every market sector managed to close in the green. However, real estate closing at number one and gaining the gold medal. Energy been performing or overperforming all week. And on Friday, the story was no different. We see energy here capturing the second place and the silver medal. Industrials coming up at number three and capturing the bronze. What about the weekly performance? Energy overperforming by far, capturing the gold medal for the week and the first place, while financials closing at number two and capturing the silver. And we see real estate at number three with the bronze. What lagged this week? Consumer cyclicals, technology, communication services. It has been a very clear theme in the market's activities this week. A rotation toward value names, while we saw the risk on momentum slash growth names declining and lagging the rest of the market. What's going on in the futures market? We see crude oil declining on Friday by about 2.5%, even though energy names managed to outperform. Perhaps we will see declines to come in energy stocks because they have the tendency to lag the action in the actual crude futures. What about softs? We see coca and OJ outperforming, while we see lumber, coffee, cotton, sugar pretty much muted, with notable declines in coffee during Friday's trading activities. What's going on with metals? Gold, silver, platinum, copper, all in the green, outperforming, but we see palladium lagging the market. What about meats? Big declines in meats, live cattle, feeder cattle, lean hogs, all declining by more the 1%. We saw significant gains specifically for feeder cattle the last few weeks, and it is about time to see a retreat and a decline, even if it is for a little while. What's going on with grains? Muted across the board, some notable gains for wheat and rough rice, but also notable declines for oats and canola, both declining by more than 1.5%. Moving on to the action in the big casino, the options market. We see NEO as the most active name in trading, closing with about 3.4 million contracts. About 56.7% of those were calls. And we're starting to see the sentiment shift in NEO from bullish to bearish, and I expect the name to continue to decline in this upcoming week. We will cover NEO's chart during the charts analysis. But we do have Apple closing at number two with about 1.2 million contracts. About 63% of those were calls. Tesla number three with a little over 615,000 contracts. About 49% of those were calls. Any interesting trades during Friday? Some, but all in all, the volume in the stock market, in the options market, was pretty much muted, with exception to NEO. But we do see a bullish bid here for TSM Taiwan, and we're seeing this theme of bullish bids for this name consistently throughout the week. And in this case, they're buying the 100 calls expiring December 4th, expecting a gain of more than 7%. And we do see KSS, this is Kohl's. We have massive retail earnings coming up this week, and we see a bearish theme when we analyze the bets for Kohl's. Kohl's not getting any calls this week. And the first bearish bet here, buying the 22 puts expiring this upcoming week with expectation of declines of more than 9%. Here is another one, buying the 19 puts, expecting further declines with expiration date similar to the previous trade. And the last one at the bottom of the table, you see them buying the 21 puts, also expiring this upcoming week. The bearishness is very notable in this name. But not all retail names are being treated equal. Check out TJX, TJ Maxx. We do see a bullish bet here, buying the 65 calls expiring this upcoming week. And again, we do have earnings across the retail sector. And again, the flip side of the coin, we do see puts being bought on TJX as well, buying the 55 puts expiring this week. And you do also see a call here for calls, KSS, buying the 25 and a half expiring by the end of the week. However, when you analyze bearish bets versus bullish bets, the overwhelming majority are betting on declines for this name right after earnings. We do see here bullish bets for Wynn Resorts, also expiring by the end of the week. This looks to me a little bit of a wild shot unless this trader has some insider information, because they're buying the 110 calls expecting a gain for about 20% or so in this upcoming week alone. And here at the bottom of the table, we see bullish bets for Chinese names, starting with JD. They're buying the 105 calls expiring in December 18th. Meanwhile, Alibaba, we've been waiting and waiting and waiting for a rebound in Alibaba. We haven't gotten it yet. This particular trader is betting on a rebound of about 7% or so for Alibaba to reach the strike price of 280 by the end of next week. Not this upcoming week, but the week after, with expiration date of 27th of November. And here is the last bit of interesting trades we have for you. You see the first call at the top of the table for ROST. This is Ross Stores. And again, it is the same theme with retail earnings coming up this week. In this case, they're buying the 114 calls expiring by the end of the week with expectations of gains more than 5% and a half. But likewise, the flip side of the coin, you see here a bearish bid for ROST, buying the 97 and a half puts, expecting a decline of about 10% or so by the end of this upcoming week. And the theme here is very similar to calls. The bearish bids expecting massive declines, and that is for two reasons. Retail names had massive gains in the last few weeks, and traders are expecting the results would not live up to the stock price, and we will see massive declines. But also, holders of these names, Ross Stores, Kohl's, TJ Maxx, any name, when they buy puts, they go further out of the money. And this is why you see the bearish bet expecting about 10% decline or so. However, the bullish bet is only expecting a gain of 5.5% in the case of ROST. And by the way, this could be the same trader who owns a lot of Ross Stores stock. And what they're doing basically is they're buying protection, selling upside calls and making about $1.15 from selling these calls. And then they're using some of the money and they're buying protection on the downside if Ross declined 10% or so, and these puts cost them about 40 cents a piece. It is a very smart structure to protect your shares if you are a share owner in Ross Stores. We are not going to talk about NEO because we've seen a lot of gambling activities in this particular name. But we do have Peloton, and they're buying the 95 puts, expecting a decline of over 5%. And the expiration date for this trade is on the 27th of November. So I guess this particular trader believes that Beyonce will not save the inevitable of the overvaluation in Peloton. Another interesting trade for the semiconductor industry, we saw Taiwan, and now we're seeing AMD. They're buying the 91 calls expiring this upcoming week. Very big bet, expecting 11% or so of gains in a single week. This is, of course, a wild bet, but it could be an AMD shareholder selling way out of the money calls to raise some cash. And now to the headlines that shaped the day. And right away, we heard from New York Fed President Williams. And Fed President Williams says the US economy is still in a quote-unquote deep hole, and rising infections of the virus pose further risk. Now, quote-unquote deep hole is a very big word to use from a sitting Fed president. Number one, it shows you that the internal data that they have are very pessimistic. Furthermore, it shows their failure, that their cocaine liquidity operation of flooding the market only to benefit wealthy public companies and the 1% has failed to save the economy. And all of what they did is expanding their balance sheet by over $3 trillion and racking up an enormous debt for the federal government. However, if you are scared from these comments from New York Fed President Williams, rest assured, because there is another Fed president who happens to be hyper bullish. His name is Bullard. It is in his name to be an extreme bull. And perhaps old viewers of this channel know that Fed President of St. Louis, James Bullard, has been doing a significant amount of hash lately. And he's been projecting this rosy picture about the economy, saying that the recession is over and it only lasted for 2 months. And we will see a full recovery by the end of this year. Furthermore, Bullard projects that the Q4 GDP will be one of the biggest of all times. And in this case, Bullard says that the rebound is notably stronger in the jobs market than the last recession of 2009. However, you would think that if we are recovering to the pace that Bullard is projecting, that we don't need further quantitative easing and monetary policy intervention. But rest assured, Bullard says the Fed is not thinking about raising interest rates anytime soon. So which one is it, James? Is it that we're having the fastest, strongest recovery of all times? And if that is the case, then why the hell do we still need the Fed's cocaine? And by the way, Fed President Bullard is living in the world of hashish, where reality doesn't exist, and he pretty much lives in a parallel universe where there is no recession and the economy is booming and everybody got a job and consumer confidence hitting all times high and disposable income at all times high. And we just can't wait to spend because we got a lot of spare money. But here is the reality of the situation, Mr. President Bullard. The total number of people, and this is according to the BLS, the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And this is from the last jobs report, by the way. It says that the total number of people claiming benefits in all programs, meaning unemployment programs, unemployment benefits, for the week ending October 24th was 21,157,111 people. When you compare that to last year's number, it was only about 1.4 million. So we do have about 20 million people still claiming benefits from unemployment. How is that faster and better than the last recession, Mr. Bullard? The last recession's unemployment numbers were nowhere near the numbers that I'm showing you right now. And this is not even the worst of it. Continuing, nearly 3.6 million Americans were out of work for at least 27 weeks in October. A stunning, and that's what it is, it is a stunning jump of nearly 50% from September. This is the piece of statistic that the media and the analysts community chose to ignore from last month's jobs report. It is deeply troubling and it's deeply disturbing. And I agree with Fed President Williams, that we are in a deep hole, and this is the proof. We are now shifting into permanent unemployment. And I know that President Bullard's hashish says that we will reach full recovery in the jobs market by the end of this year. You will need 100 Moses to perform miracles to get to that conclusion. Because in addition to the very horrible numbers that I just showed you, here is another projection. More than 13 million people, additional 13 million, could lose their unemployment benefits at the end of December, meaning that the consumer purchasing power will continue to get hammered and dwindle and decline significantly. How will that, by the way, affect the fourth quarter earnings for corporations? Doesn't take a genius to figure this one out. Continuing with the theme of the amazing recovery we're seeing in the economy, according to San Luis Fed President Bullard, at least 79.5 million Americans live in households that are having difficulty paying usual expenses. And I showed you that a stunning number of Americans have stopped paying their mortgages and rents. They have no money to pay, and they're way behind in their bills. And without stimulus, we're not just talking at this point $1,200. We need more than $2,000 each to get out of this hole. And we are talking about the slice of Americans that have not, who are way behind on their bills and mortgages, because at some point they will get hit by eviction notices and lawsuits. That money is not just forgiven. The fact that you did not pay rent and you are behind on your bill, it does not mean that that amount of money is just gone and they're going to forgive you about it. It will add up and they will sue you and they will ask you to pay it. And if you can't, a lot of Americans will have to file for bankruptcy without any further government intervention. And I'm showing you this news to show you the contrast between the bullshit La La Land world the stock market is living in and San Luis Fed President Bullard is living in versus the reality. This is reality versus La La Land of the stock market. And the stock market can be divorced from reality for a long time. However, sooner or later, the reality will catch up to the pipe dream. And by the way, it was a no-brainer. Americans would spend more this holiday season with a $1,200 stimulus. Duh, right? You give people free money, they're going to spend it. What happens when they spend it? It will save the fourth quarter earnings for public corporations. But the question is, does the stimulus really solve the problem when the majority of unemployment is turning into permanent unemployment? What happens 3 months, 4 months from now? Even if we pass the stimulus, we're going to need another stimulus. And you see the cycle of addiction, not just for the stock market, but for the economy as a whole. Until and unless they decide to solve the root causes of the problem and address the wealth income inequality gap, this will be the future. The economy will not be able to sustain itself without the supply of cocaine, aka monetary and fiscal stimulus. And by the way, here is some more good news for you average folks who are struggling to pay your bills and your mortgages. Inflation is rising for the sixth straight month. And we're talking here about U.S. wholesale prices, and it's specifically for higher food costs. You lost your income. You're losing your unemployment benefits. You're struggling to pay the bills. You're struggling to pay mortgages. Your unemployment, temporary unemployment, is turning into a permanent unemployment. And on top of that, the prices for everyday goods, specifically food prices, are rising around you significantly. This is what this monetary and fiscal policy has achieved: choking the poor and the middle class to death. And now this inflation will continue to rise higher and higher. We will see a phenomena called stagflation. Remember, if you do see stagflation happen next year, remember that you heard this first on this channel. We've been projecting a stagflation, a 70s-like stagflation environment that will take place very, very soon. And it will destroy the economy. And it will destroy the stock market. Meanwhile, James Bullard says we're not thinking about raising interest rates, meaning hello stagflation. They will do anything to protect the rich from high interest rates, but they have no problem choking the poor and the middle class from every single corner. And there you go. Michigan consumer sentiment collapsed significantly, and it came well below expectations. And here is CNBC Rick Santelli saying it was a big miss, quote unquote, regarding consumer sentiment, adding that the estimate was 82. And what do we got here? We got 77. But here is a reminder. But remember, this is a preliminary figure, meaning that they have to go back to the kitchen and recook it and give you a Fugazi number in the next few weeks. You can't hide reality here. And with all this bad news, that I just presented for you. Very worrisome and very disturbing pieces of data. You cannot be optimistic when you see and hear all of the data I just presented for you. But the mania in the stock market and the divorce between the stock market and the real economy continues. And now we're seeing that the bullish sentiment has risen to the highest level since January 2018, right after passing the corporate tax cuts. By the way, remember what happened after January 2018? In February, we had one of the biggest crashes in history. And this is what we're heading to again. And by the way, when market participants are asked, where will be the direction of the next 10% move in the stock market? 63% of them said that the direction will be higher, further illustrating the extreme hyper-bullish sentiment in the market right now. We have bad news around us from COVID, from the jobs market, corporate earnings plateauing. However, the sentiment in the market is extremely bullish. What does that tell you? And by the way, keep in mind that corporate insiders are selling stocks in the fastest pace since 2012. Smart money dumps, dumb money picks. And here it is. This is the most important piece of data. This week, global stocks saw over 44.5 billion in net flow in the market, 32.5 billion in US stocks alone. By the way, at some point, this was the second highest ever. However, by the end of the day, it became the highest inflow in stocks ever in history, meaning that we are now have reached the most extreme level of hyper bullishness. And here is a piece of news to illustrate to you the La La Land mania that we're living in the stock market. Dating app Bumble is planning a 2021 IPO with extreme overvaluation. Remember, this is a dating app that's going to be worth tens of billions of dollars. Give me a break. But it is an illustration of the same environment that we have seen back in 1999 and 2000, when garbage companies starting IPOing, and we saw hyperinflation in valuations for companies, not only without profit, but without revenue. And the IPO of Bumble is perhaps a very clear illustration for an upcoming market top. By the way, I don't think that Bumble will IPO successfully, meaning that the market will crash before that, and they will be too scared to IPO, and they will just take it off the table. And speaking of the mania, let's check on the Robinhood idiots. What are they doing? And here we have a report saying that when Robinhood users pile into a stock, aka their Naruto style stampede, in large numbers, the average excess return on the day surges to 14%. And then come the bag holders, the morons, and we see that the surge is followed by a reversal of nearly 5% over the subsequent months. And you see, as the chart illustrates for you, when the Robinhoodites pump, it is a good time to short because these morons are only creating pumps and dumps in the market and leaving a trail of destruction behind. Whether you're talking about Kodak or Sorrento, Innovo, Hertz, and all of the dumb names they've been investing in. We know they created pumps and dumps earlier in cruises and airlines. And now the latest achievement is the EV market. We're talking about NIO, XPeng, Li Motors, but specifically NIO. They did a massive stampede, creating a big gamma squeeze. And we saw NIO gaining over 1,000%. But the pump is over and here comes the dump. And by the way, the majority of the Robinhood idiots, they don't know how to take profits. They think that stocks go up and up forever. And what happens is the majority of them enjoy the quote unquote gains of the pump, but they don't take their profits. And they also happen to take the ride down. So what is the point here? You had a high of euphoria and adrenaline bragging to everybody that you made 70%, 100%, you doubled, tripled your money. And then few weeks later, you lose it all. What is the point here? You're better off going to the casino and betting it all on red. At least you'll know right away whether you're going to win or lose. And here it is. Robinhood idiots users are more subject to attention biases, wrote the author, including behavioral finance pioneer Terence Oden. The combination of naive investors and the simplification of information is associated with herding episodes. And we see them taking significant amount of risk by gambling via options. It is not stocks. The Robinhood its mania and phenomenon is led by the boom in options trading, meaning that they're betting on the riskiest way to invest in the market. And a lot of them will end up victims. Some already did. They bought the market on the March lows and they had a great time for a few months. And then they put it all on one bet in September, buying tech names on the dip that didn't work out for them. And they lost everything they've made. And by the way, speaking of the attention biases of the Robinhoodites, I issued a tweet explaining the evolution of EV investing. First, they moved on from investing in combustion engines such as Ford, and they piled in and bought Tesla. Tesla was their cult holding. And then came Neo, the next shining object. And they dumped Tesla and they piled on Neo. And it didn't take long before another shining object called Xpeng appeared in the market. And they started dumping Neo and buying Xpeng. And now Xpeng is not cool anymore. And there's something new called Li Motors. And next week, Li Motors is not going to be cool and something else will take its place. Illustrating that the Robinhoodites have no investment thesis. They just chase whatever shiny object you present to them. And by the way, don't forget one of the top 10 hilarious investing mistakes that the Robinhoodites did this year. They bought a pharmaceutical company's stock called Lucid Pharmaceuticals. The morons thought that they're buying Lucid Motors, the electric vehicle maker. And they piled in into Lucid Pharmaceuticals so much that the stock exploded higher and had to issue a stock split. And of course, as a result, Robinhood were very embarrassed by the moronic trading behavior that the Robinhoodites were creating in the app. And they decided to block their API so none of us will see what the Robinhoodites are doing.
COVID.
And now, moving on to some COVID updates. On Friday, we've heard from Oregon Governor Kate Brown issuing a quote-unquote freeze order for businesses in Oregon, which is another fancy word for a lockdown. Now we have California, New York, Chicago, and now Oregon. And today, we've heard from the state of Washington, also closing indoor dining, gyms, bars, etc. And ladies and gentlemen, we are heading for a pretty much national lockdown, whether you like it or not. Has the market, by the way, factored in a widespread lockdown? Not even close. This will come as a massive shock to the system in the market. And here is what I mean. This is the COVID projection by January 20th, when President-elect Joe Biden will take office. And you see that the projection is broken into three terms. Number one, with mandates easing, meaning no lockdowns, no masks, etc. By January 20th, if this is the case, we will have over 4,000 fatalities every single day. Now, the mid-ground projection says over 2,000 fatalities per day. And with universal mask wearing, which we know not going to happen in this country, we will have over 1,100 fatalities per day. Still a stunning number, no matter how you look at it. Meaning that even if we don't have national lockdowns before we reach January 20th, when President Biden takes office, he will take the presidency at the peak of COVID-19 fatalities and cases, meaning that the probability of a national shutdown increases significantly and becomes unavoidable. Furthermore, here are the projections for the daily infections. And again, by January 20th, if we don't have lockdowns already, we will have over 720,000 infections per day. Stunning number. And the mid-ground projection, the current projection, says over 300,000 will be infected every day by January 20th. And again, if we do have universal masks, we will report over 180,000 cases by January 20th. Either way you look at it, the lockdowns are coming in a massive, widespread ways. They can delay it. They can try to avoid it. Red states can play whatever they want, but the fatality rates are rising significantly. More people are going to die. You're seeing that already happening in Texas, in El Paso County, and the state of Texas will be forced one way or the other to issue lockdown orders. Arizona, Florida, etc. Even if that doesn't happen, when Biden takes presidency, he would take it exactly at the peak of the virus, meaning that he will have to issue a national mask and lockdown order. And by the way, from that point on, we will see cases declining either way. And Biden will take the credit saying, hey, look, the national mask order and the national lockdowns defeated the virus. Very good politics for President-elect Biden. And by the way, speaking of COVID, here is Reverend Elon Musk. And he issued confusing tweets saying that he got tested 4 times, showing twice that he is positive for COVID-19 and twice that he's negative. And he's playing this card saying that the tests, you cannot trust the tests. And now the update. Reverend Elon says that he is most likely, quote unquote, has a moderate case of COVID-19. Now, if you read the comments of the tweet from Reverend Elon, you see a lot of public personalities bad-mouthing and attacking Reverend Elon Musk, meaning that this guy is damaging his own brand significantly. The majority of these public personalities are the wealthy liberal elite that are likely to buy Teslas. Tesla's brand is attached to Elon's brand, and Elon has been doing a lot of damage since this coronavirus pandemic started to his own personal brand and to Tesla's brand as well. And now a lot of people, specifically in liberal areas, which are the core customers for Tesla, are saying we are embarrassed to buy the car because of its association to Reverend Elon Musk. So again, he continues to damage the brand, and I do see more pain to come for Tesla shares. The peak is already here, and Elon will have no one else to blame but himself and his stupidity and the moronic tweets he's been issuing lately. And now moving on to the heat map analysis. And right away we see the heat map for Friday. It is a sea of green across the board. The action in Microsoft, Apple, Facebook, Netflix muted, but we see one big box of technology that is outperforming, and that is Google. We talked about this theme early on. It is not just that their earnings surpassed the estimates, but you could make the argument that Google wins either way, whether we have a lockdown or not. And you see traders and investors here agreeing with this sentiment. What lagged the day, by the way? We see Nvidia, the weakness in Nvidia continues, but we see strength in Taiwan, Qualcomm, Applied Materials, and Lam Research. And by the way, when you look at the action in the options market, it is no wonder why Taiwan TSM has been outperforming the rest of the semiconductor sector. A notable winner here on Friday was Cisco. Check out Old School Tech, up over 7% and led the gains in the Dow right after their earnings report. Moving on to communication services, and we see another day of gains for Disney after the earnings, Comcast. However, the notable decliner here, Zoom, down another 5% or so, about 6% in the red. And you see the ticker CHL, that is China Mobile. And the Trump administration issued restrictions on investing in this name. And you see it down over 4%. And by the way, right next to it, T-Mobile continues to gain quietly day after day. And again, their earnings report, it cannot get any better than T-Mobile's earnings report. It was excellent. A+. Moving on to communication services, and we see that Alibaba is the notable decliner once again. Very painful week for Alibaba, and we will discuss and revisit the chart and talk about it in details. But you also see pain in Wayfair, and the chart of Wayfair is starting to look very, very bearish. Massive gains for General Motors, all the reopening names, Marriott, casinos, cruises, restaurants, all in the green massively. What's going on with consumer defensives? Rebound in beer, Cisco, Tyson, liquor, Procter & Gamble. You see even Costco gaining, tobacco. So we're seeing, again, the same theme on Monday happening on Friday. Big rebound for real estate as we see the 10-year treasury yields declining after massive weeks in days of gains. And when you see a reversal and decline in the TNX, you see gains in real estate and utilities. What about basic materials? Big day for copper. FCX, Freeport McMoRan continues to be a massive gainer and winner either way. Opening or lockdowns, Freeport McMoRan wins due to the surge of demand on copper from China. Industrials, we see a resumption of the theme for Monday happening on Friday. Big gains for Boeing, Raytheon, Emerson, but also gains for FedEx and UPS. And this is the difference here between Monday and Friday. Friday was the tide that lifted all boats. However, on Monday, we saw only reopening names gaining. We go below to energy. Big gains for Chevron, Exxon. I'm not sure how sustainable these gains in energy would be, specifically as we enter more lockdowns. What's going on with healthcare? Rebound in Pfizer, finally, over 2.85%. And you see names such as MDT, Abbott Laboratories, McKesson, all closing in the green. And you see Johnson & Johnson, which we recommended to buy on this channel, also gaining. Overall, a very good day for the healthcare sector. What's going on with banks? Right away, you see gains across the board. However, remember the treasury yields reversed lower, so we're perhaps looking at a short for the KRE that tracks regional banks. Let's contrast the picture from Friday with the picture from the week overall. What do we see here? Massive gains for financials, the reopening names, energy, industrials, apparel, restaurants, cruises, airlines, resorts, Coca-Cola, tobacco, beer, Cisco, all gaining significantly. What is lagging? Again, it is the same theme for Monday that stuck for the entire week. You look at the financial sector, what is the bright red box right there? PayPal, the market punishing PayPal and rewarding reopening names. Nvidia down big, Square down big, Adobe, Microsoft, Shopify, ServiceNow, Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, Alibaba, Tesla, Lulu, Home Depot, Lowe's, Wayfair, Clorox, all of these lockdown slash stay at home names got punished severely this week. Will this picture sustain? I doubt it. With the rising cases of COVID and now the lockdowns, the big question is, are we going to reverse back the stay-at-home stocks, or are we going to sell everything and panic once again? That is the $1 million question. And by the way, before we move on, let's check on the weekly performances for the ETFs. And the picture here is very interesting. Check out the reverse index for the Dow, for example, the S Dow, down over 12%. Meanwhile, the inverse index for the Qs, for the NASDAQ, the short triple Qs, managed to close in the green about 3% or so. And again, it is the contrast between reopening versus stay at home. Massive losses here for the FAS, tracking the inverse index for the financials. Massive gains for the KRE, but we are looking for a short here. Remember that. And you see small caps outperforming this week. The IWM, the IJR closing over 6%, 7% respectively in the green. And we see pain in the TZA, which tracks the inverse index for small caps, getting capped on the knee here, down over 17.5% for the week. And right away, you see the contrast between growth. The IWF was down over 1% for the week. However, value, the IWD, was up over 5.6% this week. Picture could not be any clearer. Moving to value, reopening names, and departing from growth and stay-at-home names. The notable thing here, look at the UVXY and the VXX. The UVXY is down 11% this week on a very massive week for the SPY and the Dow Jones. Remember, last week, the UVXY was down over 30%. So this week, even with the massive gains for indices, you see the VIX and the UVXY not down to the magnitude they're supposed to decline at after we saw the indices' huge gains this week. So the question is the VIX just lagging? We will see massive declines this upcoming week, which will translate to a huge market rally. Or is the VIX sending a message saying, yes, there was a party in Wall Street. However, we're being cautious here and we're seeing some bids buying the VIX and thus muffing the degree of impact that the VIX could have gotten from these massive gains from the indices this week. And moving on to the rotation trade. And right away, you see a very clear picture of overperformance from the reopening names. Massive gains across the board. When you look at Alta, Cisco, Chevron, American Express, these are massive, massive gains. What did I do? Because I have a lot of names from the reopening names in my portfolio, I took profits, and in certain instances, I sold my entire positions, meaning that I'm fading the pop, but I'm also not migrating to the other side, to the reopening, or excuse me, the stay-at-home slash growth names. I'm not doing that. I am bidding on a market reversal that will happen soon that will impact both sectors to the downside. And we saw a little bit of taste of that prediction on Thursday. The notable activities here for the stay-at-home names: you see massive pain for Peloton, Zoom, DocuSign. These are the hot names that the Robinhoodites and traders prefer when they bid on further lockdowns and stay-at-home environment. And of course, notable that Google and Apple managed to close in the green. Remember, all of these declines that you see on the screen right now don't matter. At the end of the day, it's all about Apple. And this is why we track Apple 120. If Apple doesn't go down, Apple could lift the entire NASDAQ and the Qs single-handed. So with that weakness in Apple, I'm not buying this rotation yet. Moving on to the charts analysis, starting with the SPY from 15 minutes perspective. We saw the bear flag playing down, going all the way to the support level of 352. And now we saw formation of a double bottom, resulting the SPY to gap higher. And again, this is the mysterious entity that has been popping the stock market overnight, that you see all these gaps higher. And of course, they're hoping that you guys, the retail traders, will take it from there and buy the SPY and the Qs and everything else. And then they dump on your heads and leave you as a bag holder. Where do we see the resistance? 359. We reversed, not a 359 exactly, but short below it. And it remains the level to break for the SPY. Very important level to watch. If we gap again above 359 due to the mysterious entity bidding overnight, that means that we will march to challenge all times highs. However, if my prediction is true and we see reversal and a decline in the indices, we will look at the 352 for support. And if we break below that, we will take it one day at a time and we will identify new support levels. Now let's move on to 1 hour chart and present the bull case. The bull case says, look at the previous circle, that yellow circle, the big one that I'm highlighting for you. And you see the formation in white, right in that blank space of sort of a W swoosh hybrid, where we see the chart declining, catching a bit, but not all the way to the highs from which the decline, and then going back again, catching support from the double bottom, and then breaking above the old high. You saw it happen before, and the bulls are saying that that will happen again, and we will defeat all times highs. We might struggle there a little bit, just like you saw back in the old case from September, but we will eventually break all times highs and march higher. Now here is the bear case saying, whoa, 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 wait a minute. You are cherry picking here, bulls. What we are seeing is no different than the reversal from September, which was very hard reversal. And what we've seen is not a W swoosh hybrid, but a W meltdown hybrid, meaning that we decline in the first shock, the first leg, we bounce, but we fail to reach the high levels from which we reverse, and then we catch support from the double bottom, but we come short again and we reverse further to the downside. And that is what the bears are trying to sell here, saying that we will decline from this point on. We will go down and start closing some of those gaps that we've created from the mysterious entity overnight. And by the way, when we switch to a daily chart, here is the bull case. And you probably have seen this formation or this analysis on other YouTube channels, basically saying that we are seeing a descending line that is acting as resistance. And on the third attempt, we managed to break above it. And yes, we had a reversal, but we had a retouch of the same line that is now acting as support. And eventually we will start marching higher. But we are now in extreme bullish territory because we managed to break the descending line of resistance. And here is the bearish case. The bears are saying, yeah, you could have a descending line, but either way, we're seeing a bear flag formation which will take us at least to retouch the descending former resistance line. And now let's switch to the Qs from a 15 minutes perspective. What do we see here? The Qs trading in range, not a significant development as we are seeing in the SPY. The resistance remains at 292, and the next support we have here at 285.70. Remember that the 292 is very solid resistance, and the only way you can break above it is by another overnight pump and a gap higher. But I doubt that we can break above it in normal trading activities. And what do we see here in the Qs from a daily perspective? Again, it is a bear flag formation since the reversal from Monday, and it will take us down eventually to close the big gap at around 274.70. Is there a bull case here? Not really. I can't see it. Maybe others can see it on the Qs chart from a daily perspective. I certainly can't. But perhaps if we switch to a weekly chart, we can see some bullish activities here. Whoops, no we don't. Because this week's candle reversed and closed below the closing of last week's candle. Again, it is not a significant bearish signal, but it shows weakness in the Qs and lack of momentum and participation from retail traders to push the Qs higher above all-time highs. That could all change if we see retail participation this week, but I do doubt it. And here is a chart, a weekly chart for the Dixie, the dollar index. We are seeing that the dollar index had a mini, very baby reversal from last week's candle. And the question here, is there a last act for the dollar index to do before collapsing lower? Could happen, specifically if we see a rout in the market in general, we could see a rush to raise cash and we see a surge in the dollar index. But all in all, the chart looks very, very weak. And in the long term, we're looking at massive declines for the dollar index. What's going on with gold? You see a big reversal candle for gold. However, we closed above the lows. We saw a mini reversal in gold throughout the week, right after the activities on Monday. Again, gold is bounded to the action in the dollar index. And the levels we're looking at here, 1800. If we see gold going down all the way back to 1800, that would be a very good level to watch and consider buying gold. Likewise, if we recapture 1925 in gold, understand that the declines were temporary in gold and we will see a reversal and a march to the upside from that point on. So I'm watching these two levels very, very closely in the gold chart. Moving on to the VIX, and this is bad news for bears. Remember, we are eyeing a closing, a weekly closing above 24.8 for the VIX, and the VIX had every opportunity this week to do so. It failed, it reversed, it just peaked above it and closed below it, I would say decisively. You can read it two ways, and I'm not going to sugarcoat it because I read the charts the way they're presented to me. And the way the VIX chart is presented to me as there is lack of appetite in buying protection, meaning, and we covered this during the headlines of the day, the sentiment is very, very bullish and it's likely to push the market higher and collapses the VIX further to the downside. But there is a flip side to the coin in which you cannot see this bad closing for the VIX necessarily as that we will see bullish activities to follow in the market. It could be a signal, an illustration of the complacency in the market and the lack of appetite to buy protection, meaning that traders and market participants could be caught in the wrong side of the trade and you see a surprise surge in the VIX. That is, of course, what bears want. But again, when I read the charts, I leave the biases out and I read them as I see them. And closing below 24.8 is bearish for the VIX. I'll stay open-minded and give the VIX the benefit of the doubt this upcoming week, but if it doesn't move higher in a significant way, understand that the bulls will have total control of the market. They will push it to all-time highs. Perhaps Dow 30,000 becomes a psychological level to achieve, and you see the VIX declining further and further, perhaps back to its natural habitat between 12 and 15. Moving on to the TLT, and we see a reversal to the upside. We need to see a continuation to this momentum, meaning the market participants are eyeing the surge in yields as an opportunity to lock in some bonds. If that continues, this upcoming week and we see the TLT rising higher, it means a shift away from stocks to bonds, meaning that the indices will decline. So we're keeping a very close eye here for the TLT. What do we see in the TNX, the 10-year treasury yields? Again, it was a reversal to the downside before reaching the important psychological milestone of 1%. But it is not a decisive reversal yet, meaning that we could see another shot from the TNX trying to reach and break above 1%. So we're staying open-minded. We're watching the TLT, we're watching the VIX, we're watching Apple 120, all the conditions that I gave you before for a reversal. You saw a little mini taste of that happening on Thursday when all of these conditions were met. However, the market did not sustain the reversal in TLT and the reversal of Apple from 120, and you saw the very bad closing for the VIX. So we'll continue to watch these three conditions in this upcoming week. And speaking of Apple 120, here we go. Apple trying to climb its way back and re-challenge 120. What we are looking for is harsh rejection and a reversal from 120, meaning that Apple fails and even breaks below the next level of support of 117. We have not seen that rejection happen yet. We saw some of it taking place on Thursday, but it was a soft rejection, not a harsh one, which we are looking for. What's going on for Tesla? Here's a weekly chart. And again, Tesla failing for the third time, third week in a row to recapture the old trend line. We see the MACD crawling further down, the RSI, similar story, meaning that the name is becoming weaker in terms of momentum. And perhaps you're seeing the effects of the migration from Tesla to NIO to XPeng to Li, etc. I expect further declines for Tesla from this point on. And now let's review some of the charts and the calls we made throughout the week. We made bullish calls for Costco, Kroger, Suburban Propane, and Johnson & Johnson. And we made bearish calls for NIO, Sony, MasterCard, General Motors, and Dolby. And we also covered the charts of Pfizer and Alibaba in a neutral stance, and we are waiting for an entry point. So we'll go through them right away. Here is the chart of Costco. You saw the big impulsive decline on Monday. I told you that this was a knee-jerk reaction, and it is an opportunity to buy. And so far, the name from that point managed to gain about 4 to 5%, and I gave you the support line of 363.50 as the point in which you're gonna buy shares of Costco. Where is the exit point? It is the higher end of the reversal candle, in or around 388.25. Moving on to the next name, Kroger, another grocery store that saw a massive reversal on Monday, and we said this was an overreaction and it is an opportunity to buy. And you see Kroger from that point on reversing and gaining over 5% and recapturing the very important level of 32. And I see further gains from Kroger from this point on. Here is a weekly chart for Suburban Propane, another name we gave a bullish call for. On Thursday, the name gained over 7% right after the earnings report. However, we saw on Friday, the name gave up about 5% or so. And I continue to see bullish momentum for the name for the obvious reasons, since the closures and the need for propane tanks to heat up outdoor seatings for restaurants. However, the technical levels we're watching for here, you see last week's candles lows, that is the line on the sand. If we break below it, then we'll nip it in the bud and we will exit this trade because it will be bearish from that point on. However, if the prediction is right, we will see the name gathering more momentum, and perhaps third time is a charm to break the very strong resistance level of 18.20. The chart tried twice to do it from a weekly perspective and got rejected in both times from 18.20. Is third time a charm? We have to wait and see. But if we see break above 18.20, it is time to double down because the trade will gain a lot of momentum from that point on. Moving on to the last bullish call we gave throughout the week for Johnson & Johnson. We talked about the level of 149 as resistance. We expect the name to break above it. This happened exactly on Friday. You see the RSI rising, signaling that there is momentum and demand to buy Johnson & Johnson. It remains my favorite name in the vaccine trade. I do like Pfizer and other names such as Merck. However, from a charts perspective, I see the most potential for Johnson & Johnson. And my target here is around the level of 155, which will be about 4.5% gains from the time we called the trade. And now let's cover some of the bearish calls that we gave in certain names, starting with NIO. Remember on Sunday last week, I told you that we are starting to shift the sentiment from bullish to bearish on NIO, and I do see a potential for a reversal and initiating a short. But we have to wait for the signal to happen because the momentum and the gambling in the options market is still there, and it could push the name above the level of 50. This is exactly what happened. However, we saw a very harsh reversal on Friday, which in my opinion is the last straw, and we will see declines in NIO from this point on because the gamma squeeze is over. And now all of these option riders who bought the name for you to gamble with NIO options are now starting to dump. And they will dump severely and significantly. In fact, this could take the name down about 50% or so in the next few weeks. And you see my projection, I maintain the NIO will reverse and will go down to revisit the old trend line in or around the level of 28. But remember, there are significant levels of support before that, chiefly the level of 38. But again, my consensus here is that the party is over in NIO. If you made money, please take your profits off the table. Another name we made a bearish call on, Sony. And you see the big reversal candle on Monday. And I was expecting the name to go down all the way to the level of 84, expecting a decline of 3% or so. I entered the trade on Monday, so I captured the majority of the reversal, but I told you after Monday's trading activities that there is a little bit of room for further declines in Sony. We saw some of that take place, but not significant declines. And right away, Sony reversed and started trading higher. Now, the argument from the bulls is you don't want to bet on PlayStation 5. And my counter argument is if you were betting on PlayStation 5, you should have bought the name back in the summer because the name had significant gains from that point on. And now we are entering the phase of sell the news. And by the way, what got me the idea to short Sony, I set up an alarm, a reminder for the program to remind me once Sony chart reaches the level of 77.40 on the RSI. That was my line in the sand to short the name. Once I got the reminder and the alarm, I shorted Sony and it worked perfectly. Now we're seeing a reversal of the reversal and we're curling back to the level of 77.40 in the RSI, perhaps signaling a double top and a reversal for Sony in the days and weeks to come. I closed some of my puts in the name, but I will add to them this upcoming week to average down and perhaps catch another ride to the downside. Here was another chart we presented for you, MasterCard. And I said that I'm expecting a reversal to go all the way to close at least one of the gaps, creating about 5% decline or so in the name from the day I covered the chart. However, you saw a reversal on Friday, just like many other names, many other charts, you look at them and you see a reversal to the upside on Friday. Here is one scenario. The chart will ride higher all the way to revisit the resistance descending line that you see drawn in yellow and reverse from that point on to close the gap. And that would be even more gains for you if you enter the trade from the reversal at the descending trend line. Scenario number two, Friday was just a dead cat bounce, and on Monday in the days to come, we will continue the trend lower to reverse and close that particular gap and perhaps some more. So we'll continue to watch the chart of MasterCard and see what it does this week. Here is another name, General Motors, and I'm highlighting to you the point from which I bought the name and where I sold it. I bought it from the support of the trend line and I sold it at the resistance level of 41. Now again, just like other charts, General Motors reversed on Friday to the upside and closed above 41. However, I continue to maintain the 41 is a strong resistance for the name, which marched high and impulsively in the last few days and weeks, and it is time to hit the brakes and for the name to reverse and decline for at least to revisit the 20 days moving average. Moving on to Dolby. And right away, I called the short at the level of 87.20, and you saw the name declining over 7% from that point on. This was a good call. However, the name reported earnings, and after earnings, you saw it reversing back and recapturing the level of 87.20. And the question is, just like many other charts that we covered, is it going to be a double top formation? Meaning that if you did not take your gains off the table after the 7% decline, which you should have, but if you did not, perhaps this is another opportunity to average down, add to your shorts, because the level of 87.20 is a strong resistance. We'll know if that's the case or not right away on Monday. If you see DLB opening higher than 87.20, that is your evidence and signal that you should abandon the trade because the name is captured another set of momentum. My take is the name is already overheated, overbought, and the level of 87.20 remains very strong resistance, and we will see another reversal from that point once again. And here are the last two names that we were neutral on and looking for entry point. Number one, Pfizer is a daily chart. We're eyeing the level of the gap of 36.40, waiting for the chart to revisit that number and then buying Pfizer from that point on. The chart decided to reverse after visiting the 20 days moving average. Whether that's going to sustain or not, the level of 39 remains a very strong resistance. So if we see Pfizer revisiting 39, then reversing and going all the way back to the target of 36.40, I will buy Pfizer. But that is my price, 36.40. If I don't get it, I'm not buying the name. And likewise, Alibaba. I've been watching the level of 266 and hoping that Alibaba will maintain the support of 266. Unfortunately, it did not. Now, we might see a reversal in Alibaba because there are levels of support between 212.5 and 266, but they are soft resistance, not strong ones. And we also heard news that Chinese President Xi Jinping himself called the Ant IPO off the table as retaliation against Jack Ma. Jack Ma and other Chinese billionaires and entrepreneurs need to remember who is the most powerful man and who calls the shots in China. You're still a Chinese citizen. You're not going to be able to override Xi Jinping. And in this case, Jack Ma managed to piss off Xi Jinping. And you see the retaliation here against Alibaba, and Jack Ma himself lost billions of dollars this week alone. 266 was my target for a reversal. And if I saw a reversal from that point, I would have bought Alibaba. I did not see that. So for me, the boat sails with or without me. I don't care. I'm not buying in if it doesn't reverse and close above 266 decisively. That did not happen, so I'm not buying Alibaba anymore. And now, let's move on to conclude this video. We've seen significant uptick in bullishness in terms of the sentiment in the market. Matter of fact, the bullish sentiment hit all times highs with the massive amount of inflow to indices that perhaps happened overnight from the quote-unquote mysterious entity. The bullish case basically saying, look, yes, the market is bubbly and overbought, etc., etc. However, we're past the elections. We have good news about the vaccine. The wall of worry is starting to collapse. The whole contested elections thing doesn't look like it's going to happen after Arizona was called for Biden, meaning that the bullish activities and the record inflow in the market is justified because it is money that was waiting on the sidelines that is now joining the market after the wall of worry collapsed. The bear case says, wait a minute here. I think you guys are celebrating before the party even starts. We have COVID resurgence and a wave way bigger and more intense than the first wave. We're seeing employment numbers declining significantly, and we don't have a stimulus, and about 13 million people will lose their unemployment benefits in December. And we're seeing more constraints, a more weakness in consumer sentiment and spending, and not even being able to pay the rents, mortgages, and basic bills. So what will drive the earnings in the fourth quarter without the strength of the consumer present and with the surge of cases and lockdowns. And this is the battle that we are about to see heat up significantly this upcoming week. Is it the argument that the money on the sidelines will be strong enough to push the market to all-time highs in March, regardless of the macro and microeconomic conditions in the real world? Or is it that we are constructing a new wall of worries in which we see massive surge in COVID-19 cases, more unexpected lockdowns, and a lack of stimulus and fading unemployment benefits, which will shake the market by surprise and crush the bullish sentiment in the market? Very important week, very decisive week. And you know the three conditions we have identified for reversal. Number one, the VIX must recapture 24.8 decisively. Apple needs a harsh rejection from 120. And lastly, that we need to see a reversal in the bonds market and a rush to buy the TLT. We saw just a little taste of what would happen when these three conditions are met on Thursday. And you saw a reversal across all indices. Reopening trade, stay-at-home trade, the SPY, NASDAQ, the Dow, all closing in the red once these three conditions were met. If we see them being met again, but in a more bold and decisive fashion, we will see a more decisive and bold reversal in the market. So we'll keep an eye on that. And don't forget, we have very important retail earnings happening this week. Thank you for watching. If you found the information presented in this video helpful, please subscribe, press the like button, the notification button, and follow me on social media.